first. You know, there was this couple, and the name of the couple is Mary and John. Now, Mary had a dream, and she was very excited to share her dream to John. So she came running to her husband, and she told John, I had a dream, and this is my dream. In Valentine's Day, you will give me a beautiful pearl necklace. Okay, and she needed to explain because sometimes men, we don't get, you know, women or what they really want. And so she asked John, what do you think that dream means? Okay, and then John thought about it, and then he told Mary, just relax, okay? You will know the dream in time. In Valentine's Day, you will know what that dream means. So Valentine's Day came, and Mary woke up. She was so excited. She saw there was a gift in the table. And then she saw in the gift, there's a note. And the note says, I hope this answers your dream. So she opened the box, and guess what she found in the box, in the gift? She found a book entitled How to Interpret Dreams. Okay, I hope that will never happen to us. But this Tuesday will be what? This Tuesday is Valentine's Day, okay, or Singles Awareness Day. And a lot of women, you will receive gifts, you will receive chocolates, you will see a bouquet of flowers, a good dinner, and then men, what will you receive? You will receive the bill, okay? You will have to pay for all of those things. And singles, there's also a gift. Okay, enjoy your gift of single blessedness, okay, during that time. And I know we love receiving gifts. Do you guys love receiving gifts? Right? We love receiving gifts. We love the element of surprise. We love, you know, to guess what is in the box. And of course, we love receiving something that's free. Something that we didn't have to pay for, whether we need it or not. And there is one gift that I do pray that we have received. Apart from all the material gifts that we have received, I pray that this is the most important gift that we have already received. And that is the gift of eternal life. And that is the reason why John wrote the book. That he wanted us to understand that by believing in Jesus, we may have life in His name. Just to give everyone a recap as well. This is the reason why John wrote the book in John 20. Verse 31, but these things have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in His name. That is the reason why John wrote the book, that we may believe in Him, and then by believing in Him, we may receive the free gift of eternal life. And the Lord wants us to receive that gift of eternal life. But apart from that gift of eternal life, there is another gift that He gave His disciples. When He left them, there's another gift, His parting gift. Do you know what that gift is? That is the gift of the Holy Spirit. That is His parting gift to the disciples. And today, or this afternoon, we would be talking more about the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus knows what the disciples will be going through. We've been going through chapters 14, 15, and today 16. And if you would read those chapters, you would see Jesus constantly talked about persecution, tribulation, suffering, and all of those things, because these are the things that the disciples would be going through. They would be going through tremendous suffering. That's why in chapter 15, this is what Jesus says. If the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, because of this, the world what? Hates you. And in John chapter 14, Jesus mentions the word hate 8 times. He mentions the word persecution 2 times, because the point is this. He was telling His disciples, you need to understand that you will encounter suffering, that the world will hate you. And even right now, this is not only applicable to the disciples back then, but even right now, Christians are being persecuted. They are suffering all over the world. There's a country right now that is sending Christians to labor camps, that it's illegal to have a Bible or to read a Bible. You know, we have one person from the singles ministry before, but they were relocated in another country due to work. And I won't mention the country, but this country has a diverse set of beliefs, you know. And they were sharing what they were encountering. And these are the things that we won't encounter here in the Philippines. They shared a story that at times, you know, when you're in the restaurant and you're reading a Christian book or you're reading the Bible, people will approach you. Why? Because they want to have a debate with you. They want to try to convert you to their belief. They will try to question what you believe in. And they can even report you to the government if they feel that you are trying to convert them. And this is happening right now. But I know here in the Philippines, right, we don't experience physical persecution. That's why we really have to be grateful that we can come here freely without any hassle and just worship God. Although there is still that reality that even though we won't be physically persecuted, we would still experience suffering while we are here. That there are those right now in the Philippines that are being mocked, maybe because of their faith in the office or even by your family. That some of you may have experienced being rejected by your family. Some of you may have experienced being identified as an outcast by your friends because of what you believe in. Friends, persecution, tribulation, all of these things is part of following Jesus. And the question is right now, how do we handle it? When these things happen in our life, what do we need to do? How can we handle suffering and problems in our life? And Jesus tells us in John 15, verse 26 to 27. Can everyone read with me this, please? It says, "When the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, that is the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify about me. And you will testify also, because you have been with me from the beginning." And Jesus tells us that you will experience suffering and tribulation, but he will send who? He will send the Holy Spirit. It says there, the Helper, or in other translations, Comforter, Advocate, someone who will come to someone's aid to empower us in times of tribulation. But there's also a reason why he would send the Holy Spirit. And the reason is in verse 26, as 27. It says there, "And you will" what? "Testify also." Meaning that God would give us, or Jesus would give us, the Holy Spirit so that we will be empowered in times of tribulation, but also so we can be a powerful witness, so that we can have a powerful testimony. So friends, take heart. No matter what you are going through, the Lord has given us a helper, someone who would comfort us, that we may be able to go through all of these trials and pain. Take heart, because God has given us his Spirit. And that is the title of our message this afternoon. Take heart, Jesus gives us the Holy Spirit. Can you say that with me? Take heart, Jesus gives the Holy Spirit. And again, if you have your Bibles, let's turn to John chapter 16. Let's all take it one verse at a time. Let's start with verse 1, and then we'll go through verse 33 at the end. So here is what says in verse 1. It says in verse 1, "These things I have spoken to you, that you should not be made to stumble." And Jesus was saying, these things, he was referring to all the things that he said, starting from all the way through chapter 14, 15. "I have said you these things," and there's a reason, "so that" what? "So that you should not be made to stumble." Or in other translation, "so that you will not fall away." So that you will not abandon the faith. Because there's two things that can happen when you encounter tribulations or trials or persecution. It can either make you, or it can either what? Break you. Make you to be a more mature Christian, make you and build your faith, or break you and make you abandon the faith. Make you question God and ask God, "Lord, why are you allowing all of these things? I'm serving you, I'm giving everything to you, and you're allowing me this trial." That's why, friends, there's a need for us to learn this message, because we cannot escape trials and pain and problems in our life. But we can know how we can handle it through his Spirit. Because remember this, your response during trials will show your faith in Jesus. In the case of the disciples, the Lord gave them the words. And it will depend upon them if they would believe in him and believe in his words, and therefore continue, persevere, and not abandon the faith. Because again, what they will be going through is not going to be easy. Let's think about it. What will happen? After a couple of hours, Jesus will be betrayed. And then when he is betrayed, he will be handed over to the Roman soldiers. And then he will be crucified. And when you see that happening in front of your eyes, what will you feel? If you were in the shoes of the disciples, what will you feel? What will you think about? There can be so many questions running in your head, right? Why is this happening? Why is my master being crucified? Or if I was in the disciples' shoes, I will think, did I did the right decision? Or did I make the right decision in following him? If he is really God, why can't he come down the cross and just send thunder to all of these Roman soldiers? Is he really the Son of God? You know, these are all of the things that might have been going through the minds of the disciples. That's why when Jesus said this, they felt sorrow. They felt afraid. They felt confused. And Jesus continues to comfort them by saying in verse 1, "These things I have spoken to you so that you should not be made to stumble." Or simply put, Jesus is saying, when these things happen, do not think that something new is happening. I told you these things. Do not be surprised. It is expected. But here's the beauty, friends. When Jesus gave these words, when Jesus told his disciples, the world will hate you, he did not just say that. He did not just say, you will be persecuted, and that's it. He gave them words that they can cling on to, words that can give them comfort. That's why if you would read to chapter 14, 15, and even 16, these are the words of comfort from Jesus. In John 14, verse 1, this is what Jesus said. "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me." These are the words that they can cling on to when they are having a tough time in their life. And even in John 14, verse 27, "I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid." These are the words of Jesus in chapter 14. And then in chapter 15, Jesus says this, "Remember the word that I said to you, a slave is not greater than his master. If they persecute me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours." And Jesus was saying, remember all of these things. A slave is not greater than his master. Therefore, you are to expect that they will persecute you, just as they are persecuting me. But take heart, right? Trust in the Lord. Trust in God. And trust also in me. That's why, friends, I don't know what you are going through right now. Maybe some of you are going through a problem in life, but don't ever think that the Lord does not care for you. Don't ever think that the Lord has allowed you to go through this trial without His words to comfort you, because He has given you His words. But you just need to take the time to study, to know what He has said in His words, and find comfort in His word. That's why there's a first principle that we can learn based on verse 1 alone, that the first principle is this: keep in mind His what? His words. Okay? In times of tribulation, when it's not easy, remember His words. Keep in mind His words. And that is how you handle trials in your life. You soak yourself in God's word and find comfort in His word. I remember a time in my life where it was not really easy. And I won't go through the details. It's a very, very long story because it was a long relationship and all of those things. But it was a time where I was really broken, when I was really just full of sorrow. And every night, a tear was in my eye, and I was crying. And when you have problems like that, you would have so many questions, right? You would always ask God, "Lord, why? Why now? Why are you allowing this? What do I need to do?" And all of those things. And the Lord did not give me any answer on why. But there was this one verse that I always clinged on to. And it is what the psalmist said in Psalm 34, verse 18. It says, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit." That in those moments that I felt such sorrow, I just clinged on to these words, that, "Lord, you are near to the brokenhearted. Lord, you save those who are crushed in spirit. Therefore, I will put my hope in you. Therefore, I will endure and I will trust that you know what you are doing." You know, it's not really going to be easy. That's why sometimes we need to talk to ourselves. We need to preach to ourselves. And another example is another psalm. And this is what the psalmist said. He said in Psalm 42, verse 11, "Why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise Him, the help of my countenance and my God." Look at what the psalmist is doing. He was talking to himself. He was reminding himself, telling himself, "Why are you sad? Why are you in despair, oh my soul? There's no reason for you to do that. Why? Because you can put your hope in God. You can trust Him, your countenance, your refuge." That's why at times we need to remind ourselves. We need to preach to ourselves what God has said in His Word. Although, I'm not saying that you go and talk to yourself aloud. People may think you are, you know, you need counseling and not help you with your problem. But remind yourself in those moments where it's hard that there is no reason for you to be sad, because you can put your hope in God. That He is faithful. That He saves those who are crushed in spirit. And that He is our refuge. And when you do that, friends, when you remember His words, what happens? You remember His words, and then it is the Spirit who strengthens you, who allows you to go through the trial, even though it's not easy. But it starts first with knowing and remembering His word. Because again, what the disciples would be going through is not easy. That's why Jesus mentions this in verse 2. He said in verse 2, "They will put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think," what? "That he offers service to God." In verse 3, "And these things they will do to you, because they have not known the Father nor me." That there's two things that will happen to the disciples, to the apostles. Number one, based on this verse in verse 2, they will what? Put you out of the synagogues. They would excommunicate you. And there were different kinds of excommunication during that time. The lightest form of excommunication is for around 30 days, you cannot be in fellowship with your friends, with your families, with people that you know. And the worst kind of excommunication is being banned from all religious meetings, and you cannot meet your family, you cannot be with your friends, you cannot be with any other individual. And it was a painful time. You see, there's emotional persecution. But aside from that, verse 2 tells us that they would also have physical persecution. People will try to kill them, will try to hunt them down. And the sad part about this is, based on that verse, the people doing that will think they are serving God. Just like in the case of Saul, right? He was so passionate for the wrong things, thinking he was doing service to God. That's why Jesus continues from verse 1 all the way through verse 4 saying this, "But these things I have spoken to you, so that when there are comes, you may remember that I told you of them. These things I did not say to you at the beginning because I was with you." Again, friends, here you with Jesus constantly tells them, remember the things that I have told you. Remember my words. I did not tell you these things before because I was still with you. But now the time has come that I will go away and you will be persecuted. And because of this, the disciples were in sorrow. That's why Jesus tells them, if you look at your Bibles in verse 6, "I have said these things to you and sorrow has filled your heart." So it was a very, very trying time. But it's interesting what Jesus now says in verse 7. So everyone, can you please read this with me, verse 7? "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him to you." What did Jesus say? It is to your advantage. It is for your own good. And think about that. If you were the disciples, what would you want? You would want to be with Jesus. You would want to be in the presence of Jesus. So Lord, how can you say right now that it's even for my good that you would be going away? And you know what I realized in verse 7? Sometimes when we're going through trials in life, we think we know better than God. But here you would see, God is saying, "I know what I am doing. I know what is for your good. I know what is for your advantage. Even if you may not understand why all of these things have to happen. But trust in me, because I am still in control. That he knows what he is doing, despite at times it might mean suffering, it might mean pain for us. But he is always in control, and he knows what is best for us. And in the case of the disciples, it was for their advantage that when Jesus will be leaving, he would send the Holy Spirit so that the Spirit can empower them in times of persecution and can lead them into further truth. And the Holy Spirit will also help the disciples with this in verse 8. It says in verse 8, and he, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. So three things, right? We would see sin, we would see righteousness, and we would see judgment. That it is part of the responsibility of the Holy Spirit to convict the world of sin. And what is that sin? That sin that is being talked about is the sin in verse 9. It is the sin of unbelief in Jesus Christ. It is the greatest sin, not believing in Jesus Christ. That's why when you're sharing the gospel to someone, don't be offended if they won't listen to you. Don't be offended if they won't accept what you are saying, because it is not in your responsibility to convict them. It is the Holy Spirit who will convict them. But what are you to do? To make yourself available, to share as much as you can, and to be used as an instrument by God. But it is the Holy Spirit who would help us be an effective witness by being the one who will convict people of their sin. And here you would see as well that the Holy Spirit is not a force. He is a person. That's why it says there he will convict. He has personal characteristics. Okay, that's why he is not, you know, what Star Wars is referring to as the force or the force. He's not that. Because he is a very, very important person that will help us live a victorious life. He convicts, he guides, he speaks, he hears. And Jesus mentions that in verse 13. He says in verse 13, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own initiative, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will disclose to you what is to come. That's why, friends, the Holy Spirit is God, and the Holy Spirit is a person as well. A very important person that will help you in your Christian walk, that will empower you when it's tough. That's why Jesus talked about the Holy Spirit in chapter 14 all the way through chapter 16, because he is a very important individual that we need to cling on to. And it is to the disciples' advantage that Jesus would send the Holy Spirit because of this reason as well. That through the Holy Spirit, God's work can be accomplished in and through every believer. Let me repeat that. It is for the disciples' advantage that Jesus will send the Holy Spirit because through the Holy Spirit, God's work can be accomplished in and through every believer. What do I mean? Let's try to imagine, no? What if Jesus was still alive? For example, he was still alive. And he now lives in Jerusalem. Okay? So again, Jesus lives where? In Jerusalem. Okay. Now, if you want to hear the words of Jesus, where will you go? Jerusalem, right? If you want to be in the presence of Jesus, where will you go? Jerusalem. If you want to be healed by Jesus, where will you go? Jerusalem, right? It's not a trick question. You would go to Jerusalem if you want to be with him. What's the point? If Jesus was still there, his ministry will still be limited with the confines of his physical body. But when he gave the Spirit to his disciples was able to continue his ministry as they went through the different areas or locations in Judea, in Samaria, and all the way through the ends of the earth. And they were empowered that even though Jesus was not physically with them, he was with them in spirit. And even right now, that if we want to hear the words of Jesus, what do we have to do? We don't have to go to Jerusalem. We can be in our room, open our Bibles, and then as we read God's word, it is the Spirit who helps us understand the words of Jesus. And that is one of the things that we have to understand and appreciate, that we can encounter Jesus wherever we are. Even if we are just walking, even if we are in traffic, in our car, even if we are in McDonald's eating, because we can pray. And because of the Spirit in us, we now have that spiritual connection to God. That's why wherever we are, we can spend time with God through prayer, through talking to Him, and through His Spirit, that He can even use us to be His instrument for His glory. And friends, these are the possibilities because of the Holy Spirit in us, working as well through the lives of the disciples during that time. For the disciples, it was the parting gift of Jesus. But for us, it is more of a welcoming gift. That the moment that we place our faith in Jesus Christ, we are now indwelt with the Spirit. And this is what Corinthians says in verse 19. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? That's why the moment that you place your faith in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit indwells you. And it was for the advantage of the disciples that they would be indwelt by the Spirit, that they may be empowered to continue Christ, the work of Christ. And it is to their advantage as well, because if Jesus did not do that, the disciples will not be taken out of their comfort zone. What do I mean? Have you ever experienced being mentored by someone in the office? Having a mentor even in ministry, right? You have this leader. You look up to this leader. This is a good leader. And whenever you would have a meeting in the office, and your leader is there, your boss is there, you're confident, right? If there's a meeting and your boss is okay lang, because my boss can answer any question. But when your boss is not there and he's going to ask you to lead the meeting, what will you feel? You would feel a little bit nervous because your boss is not there. But you need to go out of your comfort zone. And in that process, you grow. That's why it was to the advantage of the disciples that if Jesus did not leave them, they would not be taken out of their comfort zone. They would continue to just be dependent upon Jesus. But Jesus wanted them to go. That's why He gave the commission, right? And we all know that in Matthew. What is it? What is that verse? Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Take note what Jesus says. And lo, I am with you always through His Spirit. And it's only through His Spirit that we are empowered to go and make disciples. And He wants us to be that powerful witness, powerful testimony, only through the Spirit. So, my friends, if you want to be an effective witness for Jesus, you need to understand what is the role of the Spirit in your life. That He is a person, He is God as well. And that we can take heart, that no matter what we are going through, that the Spirit is there to strengthen us, to empower us, because Jesus gave us the Holy Spirit. Again, what's the title of our message this afternoon? It is, Take Heart, Jesus Gives the Holy Spirit. It is possible to be an effective witness for Christ if we will be filled by the Spirit. It is possible to be able to be a witness despite the challenges of persecution, of tribulations. It is possible to serve even though we're so tired, even though we're so weary. And it's possible not to conform to the world and not to give in to temptations only through the power of the Spirit. Because the power that the disciples had, that they were sharing the gospel no matter if they were persecuting, is the same power that still lives in us. That's why we need to remember that what is available to the disciples before is still available to us now. That is still the same Spirit that lives inside of you, that indwells you. But the question is, are you plugged in to the right power? Are you plugged in to the right source? And here lies the difference between being indwelt with the Spirit and being filled with the Spirit. Now to share with everyone, look at this chart. When we talk about indwelling of the Spirit, it happens once. The moment that you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you are indwelt with the Spirit, and it talks more about position, that you are indwelt with the Spirit and you are placed in the body of Christ. And it is available for all who believe, for all who believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. But when we talk about filling of the Spirit, it happens what? Continuously. Okay? It's not just a one-time thing. Indwelling is a one-time thing. But if you want to be filled with the Spirit and walk in the Spirit, that's something that you need to do daily by what? By obeying. That's why it says there, for all believers who obey. That this is not talking about position, but talking about power. The power to overcome sin, the power to say no to temptation, the power to live a life that is joyful no matter what problems that you are going through. But you need to obey. Okay? You need to walk in the Spirit. You need to be filled with the Spirit. A good illustration of this is like a sailboat. I don't know if you've tried sailing before, but the moment that we accept or believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we are in that boat. But that boat will not move if your sail is not up. Or even if your sail is up, you have to ensure that that sail will follow the direction of the wind, right? And there are Christians right now who are not moving forward, who are not growing because they are in the boat, but their sail is not up. And even if their sail is up, they are not following or yielding to the Holy Spirit. Because some of us have been taught wrongly that we think that we need more of the Holy Spirit. But it's not really a matter of having more of the Holy Spirit. But the question is, does the Holy Spirit have more of you? Are you surrendering your life to Him every day? Are you yielding to Him each moment, every time that you can? Are you walking, keeping in step with the Spirit? And the reason that at times we are having a hard time doing that is because of this other illustration. That when we come to Christ, that there's the two natures inside of us. There's that spiritual nature and there's that flesh. And it's always battling. Okay? There are times where you want to do what is right, but you don't do it. There are times you do what you don't like to do, and you're having a hard time to accept that because it's always in friction. It's always battling. And at times, we're having a hard time or we're giving in to temptation because the black dog is empowering the white dog. What do I mean? The black dog will empower the white dog when the black dog, our flesh, is being fed with impure thoughts, with wrong ideas, anger, violence, bitterness, and all of those things. So it empowers the white dog. What we need to do now is feed the white dog. And we feed the white dog by our spiritual disciplines, by basically praying, reading God's word, and obeying God's word. That when we do that, when we feed the white dog now overcomes and empowers the black dog. And we walk in the Spirit and we don't gratify the desires of our flesh. And it is still the basic disciplines that we need to practice. That's why if we want to be plugged in the power of the Holy Spirit, we need to pray, read, and obey God's word. Remember those three things. And first, it is to pray. Second is read God's word. And three is obey God's word. Sounds simple, right? But I know it's not easy to do. That's why it's called a discipline. Something that you need to ensure that will be a habit, a lifestyle. Because friends, God has given us His Spirit so that we can live a victorious Christian life. He has not left us to be sheep that can easily be slaughtered. He has given us His Spirit so that we would be able to be empowered, we will be able to be strengthened. So remember, in times of tribulation, principle number one is keep in mind His Word. And principle number two is keep in mind the filling of His Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Understand that you are indwelt with the Spirit, but you need to keep walking and being in step with Him, that you may be filled with Him and be empowered to go through your trials in life. Now let's continue in John 16. As Jesus comforts His disciples, he lets them know about what will happen to them, and then He tells them that they will be overthrown, people will try to kill them, and then He says this in verse 16. He says in verse 16, a little while and you will no longer see me. And again, a little while you will what? See me. Now try to think about that. Jesus is saying, you will not see me and then you will see me. You will not see me and you will see me. What does that mean? It can mean two things. Jesus will be crucified and the disciples will not see Him anymore. But when He resurrects, they would see him again. That can be one. Another can be, Jesus will ascend, and when he is gone, the disciples will no longer see him. But they will see him again in heaven. And the point is, Jesus was saying that when this happens, there will be sorrow. But for the disciples, they did not understand. They did not understand, Lord, what are you saying? That's why this is what happens. What happened in verse 17. In verse 17, it says there, some of his disciples then said to one another, what is this thing he is telling us? A little while, and you will not see me. And again, a little while, and you will see me. And because I go to the Father. So the disciples were confused. They don't understand what Jesus was saying. And sometimes we're so easy to judge them. Because we understand, because we are looking back. We know what will happen. Jesus will be crucified. He will resurrect. Then he will ascend. Somehow we know the sequence. We understand. But the disciples was looking forward. We are looking back in terms of our faith. But they were believing in what Jesus was saying. And they did not understand. Lord, ano ba yung sinasabi niyo? That you would be gone, that I would see you again. That's why I'm trying to imagine it, and I'm trying to put myself again in the disciples' shoes. And if I was one of the disciples, I would plainly ask Jesus, Lord, are you going in a vacation? Lord, magbabakasyon ka ba? What are you saying? I can't understand that we will not see you and we would see you again. But the point is this again, friends, and Jesus gives the encouragement in verse 20. He says, truly, truly, I say to you that you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will be turned into what? Joy. And this is such a wonderful promise. That when Jesus is gone, there will be sorrow. There will be pain. We would encounter tribulations in life. But there's a promise as well. That when we see him again, there is joy. And he used a woman giving birth as an illustration. In verse 21, this is what he said. Whenever a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when she gives birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy that a child has been born into the world. And friends, I can never say that I understand what you would go through, women. I cannot say that I understand the pain of childbirth, but I know it's painful. But here's the thing, and this is such a beautiful illustration that the Lord gave us. He was saying that the same baby that caused the pain is the same baby that will cause joy. That's why the Lord is saying, when you're going through problems or trials in life, the Lord will not replace it. The Lord will not remove that. You need to go through that. But this is what the Lord will be doing. He would be transforming that pain, that sorrow, into joy. But you need to endure. That's why it's important that you remember His word, that you walk in the Spirit, that you are filled with the Spirit, because there is that promise, the result of joy, if we endure. And this is such a comforting truth that even in John 16:22, this is what Jesus says. Therefore, you too have grief now, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice. And no one will take your joy away from you. That's why there's a difference between happiness and joy. When we talk about happiness, happiness is dependent on happenings. I will be happy if this happens. But joy can be constant as we have our joy in Christ. That's why he says, this joy will not be taken away from you. No matter if you're going to any trial, this joy can still be there as you focus on me, as you see me. And at this moment, I want to ask a dear sister of ours to just share her testimony, how the Lord has turned her sorrow into joy. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Danica Tulyao.
My name is Danica Tulyao. I am the middle child in a family of three children. I have two sisters, and our relatives always call us the Tres Marias. I was born and raised in a religious family and was one until after college. I knew about Jesus, but it was not until almost a year ago that I knew him in a personal way. As a middle child, I've always felt like I had to do more than what my sisters were doing to get my parents' favor. So I did my best at everything. I studied hard and graduated with honors. After graduation, I got a well-paying job and got promoted as a manager in 2 years because of hard work. I also started looking for affection in numerous romantic relationships. At one point, I ended up leaving my fiancé, who was my boyfriend of 4 years, for a new man who made me feel happier, more secure, and complete. I also found security and joy in my work. I wanted to excel, so I did more than what was expected of me. I was always first in and last out in the office. After a year, the company gave me a car and along with other benefits. I also received accolades from my boss and colleagues. I was at the top of my game. But as the demands of the job grew and stress levels increased, my patience got thinner, time with family lesser, and my body heavier because of stress eating. Things started to shift in 2015. My relationship was on the rocks. My boyfriend and I broke up several times and would get back together a few days later. It was a vicious cycle, but I still clung to the relationship because he was my source of fulfillment. Things got tougher at work too. Our vice president, who was the brains behind bringing the car brands to the company I worked for, fell ill. This caused him to leave his post as VP and affected the company operations. By February 2016, our president announced that they will no longer continue our division. I was devastated. For someone who spent countless hours building our brands, I felt like my world was falling apart. Then it went from bad to worse. A month after that, my boyfriend finally broke up with me. And in 1 year, the loves of my life abandoned me and left me shattered. My sources of joy, love, and belongingness had been cut off. I was so empty to a point where I was in tears every night. In the middle of all this chaos, I met up with a friend along with other friends for a semi-regular hangout. She had announced peacefully and calmly that her four-year relationship had ended. I asked her how she can be so calm in the middle of a breakup, and she answered, "By God's grace." I didn't understand it then, but I told myself I wanted that. The same friend invited me to attend Morning Light, CCF Alabang Saturday Morning Fellowship. I was initially hesitant in the beginning because I told there would be sharing afterwards. I didn't feel like bearing my soul to people I don't really know. But while listening to the speaker, I felt that the message was directed towards me. I stayed for the breakout session and shared about my breakup and was crying heaps to people I just met. I continued attending Morning Light, sharing about myself, getting to know people, meeting new friends who I now consider sisters and brothers. More than that, I met the author behind the message, Jesus. I knew about the love he had to offer, a love that never abandons, love that fully satisfies. Because of that, I received God's love and accepted him as my Lord and Savior during the Singles True Life Retreat last year. I finally knew to whom I belong. I am his child, and he is my father. Looking back, I realized that I loved the wrong things. But God knew me so well that he removed things I didn't need in my life. He replaced them with what he knows I need and much, much more. Him. He has turned my sorrow to joy. Today, I am a regular attendee at Morning Light. And as we grew over time, I became more active. I also became part of a D group. And now I'm helping out with the marketing team of Morning Light. I've also pursued other Bible study groups, like the Bible Study Fellowship for Women, and I continue to learn more and more about him in the book of John. With the overflowing love of God, I have made it my ministry to disciple my family, so I can share with them the love I have come to know and receive from God. I am Danica, once a career-driven woman who found joy in the temporary things of this world, now a child of God who finds joy in my one and only Savior, Jesus Christ. May God's love fully satisfy us all.
You know, Danica is a blessing to the Morning Light team. And actually, she lives in Santa Mesa. So every Saturday morning, she would go all the way from Santa Mesa to Alabang just to attend Morning Light. And she is a testimony of someone whom the Lord has turned her sorrow into joy. So I don't know what you guys are going through right now, Maybe some of you have lost someone that you really love. Maybe some of you have lost your work. Your business is crumbling down. Maybe you are in a life-threatening experience. Maybe you are experiencing persecution right now in your office. I don't know what you are going through. But there is a promise that Jesus said that He can turn our sorrow into joy. That's why we can take heart. As we remember His words, as we keep in mind the filling of His Spirit, it can result to joy. That's why look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, take heart. Take heart, because Jesus gave us His Spirit. So friends, keep persevering in your trial. I know it's not easy. You know, normally when someone goes through a trial, their normal reaction is to feel sorrow and not be joyful, right? That's the normal response. That's why if there's a Christian who would be joyful, no matter if he is going through pain and suffering, that is only through the power of the Holy Spirit, because that's not normal. Only through Him, only through His strength. That's why keep the faith and remember those three principles. Remember, principle number one is keep in mind His words. Number two, keep in mind the filling of His Spirit. And number three, keep in mind His promise, joy. A promise is only as good as the one who said the promise. And in this case, it was Jesus, our God, our Savior, who promised that no matter if there will be sorrow in our life, there's always joy that we can look forward to. That's why we can find joy despite our pain. We can find hope despite our hopelessness. We can find peace despite our restlessness. Only through the Lord Jesus Christ. And as He ended chapter 16, this is what Jesus said in verse 33. It says this, "These things I have spoken to you, so that in who? In me." Take note of that. It's not in your success. It's not in the money that you have that you will have peace. But so that in me you may have peace. Then He continues to tell them, because the truth is, in the world you will have tribulation. He did not say you might have tribulation, but He said you will have tribulation. But the comfort is, take heart. Take courage, because He has overcome the world. The world will try to overcome us with persecution, with suffering, and all of those things. The world will try to overcome us and try to pressure us to conform to His ways, to take pleasure in Him or in the world. The world will try to pressure us to abandon the faith. And all of these things Jesus experienced. He went through suffering and persecution, but He was not overcome. He was tempted, but He did not sin. He died, but He rose again. And because Jesus overcame, through His Spirit, we can overcome as well. That there is no trial, no persecution that can overcome us if we put our focus in Jesus and find joy in Him. Friends, again, remember the three principles. Keep in mind His words. Keep in mind the filling of His Spirit. And keep in mind His promise, joy. Let's do that again. Keep in mind His words. Keep in mind the filling of His Spirit. And keep in mind His promise, joy. And friends, if you would look at these three things, you know, I see it and it's so amazing as a sequence. It starts with you remembering, understanding what Jesus said in His Word. And as you begin to know His Word and obey His Word, His Spirit fills you. His Spirit empowers you. And when that happens, it results to joy. You know, the Lord is really good and amazing. That He knows He will go through different trials, but He is there to equip us. His power is, His Spirit is there to give us comfort. That's why how I long as a church that we would show this in our life. Just think about this. How powerful a testimony it would be if everyone of us will not be overcome by our trials or our problems. That we would always have that joy. That we would always have that smile in our face only because of Jesus Christ. How shocking it is for the world to see that no matter if they are persecuting us, no matter if they are giving us trials, that we won't abandon the faith and that we would keep on persevering and keep on enduring, because we can take heart because Jesus gave us His Spirit. Again, friends, what is the title of our message this morning? It is, Take Heart, Jesus Gives Us the Holy Spirit. It is the Spirit who empowers us, and it is the Spirit as well who is the seal. And this is what Ephesians chapter 1 says. It says in verse 13, In Him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in Him with a promise, with the Holy Spirit of promise. That here you would see that the moment that we believe, having also believed, you were indwelt with the Spirit, and you now have the Holy Spirit as your seal or as your mark. Your mark that you are a follower of Jesus, that you are a child of God. And because you are a child of God, it says in verse 14 that who is given as our pledge of our what? Inheritance. Or in Tagalog, it is mana. What is that inheritance? That because you are a child of God, you now have that inheritance, that mana. And that inheritance is your place in heaven. That you may experience suffering, you may experience tribulations for the next 60 years, for the next 80 years. But there is a time where you would be in a place that you would get your inheritance, in a place where there is no longer any sorrow, no longer any pain, no longer death, but only joy in the presence of God. Isn't God amazing? Yes. And it is just a comfort for us that no matter what we are going through, there is that promise. As we end, let me just share this last story to everyone. This is a true story of a person named Milon. And Milon is from Bangladesh. And he's sharing his sufferings in life. And I want you to see his perspective, his hope, despite what he is going through. And let me read to you the story of Milon. This is his story. The angry crowd yelled after the lone bicyclist, If we see you again, we will cut off your feet. Then see if you can ride your bike. This is not the first time Milon had been threatened by angry crowds of Muslims. But such threats have not quenched his zeal to take the truth of God's word to his countrymen. This is what he said. I ride to the villages on my bicycle and carry Christian literature. In rains, I hold an umbrella in one hand and steer with the other. I often fall down, get muddy, and scratch. At night, I hold a flashlight. I sing from the Psalms when I ride. The Christians I meet do not have an extra blanket for me, so I try to make it back home to sleep. Milon was a teenager when a friend gave him gospel booklets. This is what he said. I hid them in a steel trunk in my bedroom. At night, I would get my keys and open the trunk and read with a kerosene lamp. Having studied in a Muslim fundamental school for 12 years, I had known about Jesus as mentioned in the Quran, but I did not know Him as Savior. I accepted Jesus in 1992 and was baptized secretly 400 kilometers from my home. Ever since then, Milon has been persecuted by Christians. He said, I sold clothing in the local market and began placing Christian books in my shop for other Christians. When Muslim men learned of this, they would walk into my shop, just take shirts, pants, socks from the shelf without paying for them. If I asked for money, they threatened to beat me. Anytime someone is interested in my booklets, I give them one. Then he said this very interesting phrase. He said this, We are going through many problems, but still we have Jesus Christ. We have peace through Him, and we have hope that when we die, we will go to heaven. This is the perspective, the hope of someone who, even though he is going through trials, persecution in life, but he knows his eternal destination, that we can still find joy, that we can still be hopeful no matter our trial, no matter what we are going through. Only in Jesus. So friends, keep in mind His word. Keep in mind the filling of His Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. And keep in mind the promise of His joy. Let's all pray. Oh Lord, we praise You. Father, thank You for giving us Your Son. And Lord Jesus, thank You for sending Your Spirit to strengthen us. And at this time, there might be some here who are not sure of their eternal destination. You don't have that same hope. I want to help you have that hope, that assurance that after your time here on earth, that you would be in heaven. And Jesus died on the cross, paid the penalty of our sin, that we may have a relationship with Him and be with Him in heaven. Because everyone has sinned, as the Bible says. Everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. And Jesus is only saying, if you believe in Me, if you have faith in Me, you will have a relationship with Me and you will be with Me in heaven. And if you want to take that step to believe in Jesus, to put your faith in Jesus, just follow me in this simple prayer. Allow this prayer to come from your heart. It is your own personal decision. Just pray this way. Lord Jesus, I thank You for dying on the cross for me. I acknowledge that I need You. I acknowledge that I am a sinner. Thank You for shedding Your blood on the cross. I believe that You are my Lord, my Savior, and my God. Help me live a life that has hope, that has joy, as I focus and serve You with my life. And Father, I pray for everyone that is here. You know what they are going through. You know the different pain or suffering or problems that they have. I pray right now, through Your Spirit, that You may strengthen them, that You may give them comfort, that You know what they are going through, and that You are there with them. Oh Lord, help us to be a church that would always walk in the Spirit, that we would always embody joy in our lives, that You may give glory to You in whatever we do or say. We praise You for this morning, this afternoon, and all these things we pray and we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and God bless everyone.